Welcome, everyone. I'm Angelo Robles to Angelo Robles's Effective Family Office Podcast, where I look to distill the best practices and best ideas of the world's most successful families and their family offices. I hope to provide thought-provoking opinions and feature amazing thought leaders to our listeners of the podcast with an eye towards the future of the family office. Today's podcast is titled Buying Hotels Now During COVID-19, The Ferrari of Motorcycles, and Blockchain. So if that's not a title that gets your attention, I don't know what is. So we're very fortunate today to be joined by Marco Antonio Soriano, family office, principal, investor, and entrepreneur. A little bit more about Marco. He's an American polyglot entrepreneur, venture capitalist enthusiast, family member, family office, singer, composer, ooh, a Machiavellian man of all worlds here, writer, footballer, polo rider, adjunct instructional university level professor, expert, business television commentator on Fox News Channel, CNN, CNN Espanol, Univision, RBC, RTC, Wall Street Journal, and I almost said ESPN, Marco, but it's EPN of New York. Otherwise, I'll be asking you sports questions as well, which given that nothing's being played right now, I don't know if there's a lot of questions to be asking on that. But nonetheless, Marco, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. And a big hello to everyone who's connected as well to your association.
Well, thank you. You're very kind. And I was introduced, or we were introduced, by a mutual acquaintance and international family member who has quite an amazing background herself. And we look forward to having her on the podcast. If she's hearing this, that's a little bit of a shout out to come on the show. But Marco, you have an amazing background. Why don't we just jump right into what's going to be, one, very unscripted, which is great, I think, and really covering a lot of different things, which were hinted at, and then some from the title I gave. Why don't we jump into the first one? So buying hotels now during COVID-19, I'm sure some people, investors, family offices are saying, are you crazy? Isn't that an industry that's going down, down, and down? So Why don't we start with why now could be good?
So we started this back in 2000. Well, first of all, we've been in the hospitality sector since 1950s, my family. So I grew up in it. Have we seen all sorts of crises and downturns in the economy that have affected us worldwide? Absolutely. This one in particular was another opportunistic moment. We learned from 2008, when we had the economic downturn globally as well, because that affected the sector, and we started repositioning. So there are four main points when any type of crisis really takes place in the hospitality sector that should be analyzed. One is that what type of market dislocation it had taken place, whether the existing hotels that are in distress have any sorts of operating inefficiencies, whether they are undercapitalized, and if we have any anticipated explaining recoveries in that particular sector. So we have identified that once again in core markets, capital cities of the US, and that's why we're very adamant about making these acquisitions.
So you said in the US. So I just want to have a little bit of a reference point so I know what direction to take. So in terms of buying hotels, are you looking internationally or specifically in the US?
This particular time, we're US-centric because of the way that the sector itself has been rebounding here as opposed to the way it does in Europe. Also, the government stimulation package that was given to the sector helped a lot. So it's not completely in the gutter, as opposed to other countries like Spain, Italy, France, which are typically well-known places for tourism.
True. That certainly has been, or they've been hit harder from the perspective that you noted. And when you say hotels, do you think the opportunity, is it luxury, is it in mid-level, or actually it's more economy and cost-effective hotels?
Well, interestingly enough, we like to do a full service hotel. with what's going on with COVID, we cannot be a full service anymore. So we are focusing on deliveries, even sending stuff to the rooms or even working with the restaurants around the area to help promote that.
And in terms of though, like the type of hotel, would you classify it more as luxury, mid-level, or more economy?
No, we're looking at luxury. So we're part of the luxury collection of the Marriotts and Hiltons. I always like big, strong flagships. In New York, we have the Ritz-Carlton, which we actually dropped the name of the Ritz, and we called it the Wagner Hotel, which is downtown. So it depends. Sometimes it works for us in our favor to have a very strong flagship brand. Sometimes it doesn't. So it really depends.
Now, the last crisis, like you said, kind of 07, 08, was much more of a financial crisis where basically it looked like all asset classes basically correlated, and correlated badly, I might add. There's going to be some exceptions. This has been more unique because not everything has been affected, but certain things relative to travel, which is going to be impactful for hotels, the social distancing issue. This is very different than 2007 and 2008. On the surface, I would look at it as an investor saying this is a far more challenged time compared to 07 and 08. Am I wrong?
No, you're absolutely right. It is more challenging. There aren't any norms or laws yet implied, but people do have to go back to traveling for business, some people for tourism. I mean, all these months that we have been at home, we either had to cancel our plans for this time period. So we, at one point, are planning to make that happen. Airlines, hotels have credited most of them that back to the consumer. So the consumer is going to come back and have to spend that money. So this is where we need to be ready for. As opposed to having a very expensive hotel, depending on the size, how many rooms you've got, you can buy at a much lower discount right now and just wait for the rebound within the year or so.
Oh, we're definitely going to get to that because that's going to be really where the opportunity is. But in building a little bit more of the story for why hotels, and again, I'm coming at this simply from a very basic perspective. Are you looking at major cities like New York, LA, Chicago, San Francisco, or more secondary markets?
No, primary market, core markets, high income per capita places. So we're right now in 23 different cities, LA, New York, as you mentioned, Chicago, Boston, Miami. We're buying sometimes we buy around the airports because we're sort of anticipating the business traveling to be staying within the airport area rather than to go to the center of a town or downtown somewhere to go out and about. That's not going to happen right away. I think six, nine months is what we're calculating right now.
Where am I wrong, though, in thinking that big cities like the ones we mentioned, New York and LA, there's a tremendous amount of hotels and competition? We're at a significant downturn now. Kind of, isn't there enough hotels already? But I guess you're not building a new one. You're buying an existing property?
Yeah, we're buying existing properties. We're not doing ground ups. This is what we are calling value adds. So we're operators as well. So we buy them, we operate them, we inject capital into the hotels. Sometimes they're already fully renovated. We don't even have to worry about that. It's just taking the asset from the hand of the owners that are either undercapitalized, like I mentioned before, or have operating efficiencies in place.
And I'm trying to relate this to hotels and maybe putting it too much in the COVID-19 hole, which we'll eventually get out of, and we'll get to that. But during COVID-19 times, using restaurants as the example I want to make, you know, oh, well, they need to have social distancing. They could maybe be at 40% of capacity. And we're hearing restaurant owners laugh at that and saying, I might as well not even be open because we're going to lose money unless we're closer to 70% occupancy. What's an occupancy percentage you need at a hotel to even break even?
That's very good. That's an actually excellent question. So the fact that in the last 10 years we will capitalize ourselves, allow us to have at least a minimum of 40% occupancy rate to be comfortable and good. Now, in great times in the past, If you say that 40% was good for you, people would think also that's crazy because you were expecting 70, 80, 90%. So we are at 40 right now. Our hotels, our existing hotels are rebounding already. We're at 35. So we're getting close to that point, and we see that this is happening. So it's a matter of perspective and how you operate your hotels, right?
And when you're buying into an existing property, there's always going to be the balance of if money is relatively cheap, which I guess it is now, you're going to be tempted to use more leverage. But of course, that comes at some cost and risk. Yeah. How do you balance in terms of the amount of money you put down and into it versus the leverage that you're using?
Good question, too. So what we would do is take the last 3 years operating financial statements from that particular hotel and do an average minus what we're looking at COVID happening. Because you cannot just look at the COVID time period and say, that's what you're worth right now. And there are people that are trying to do that, of course, but the hotel owners are not going to feel too comfortable with selling their properties there. So in our case, we like to sit down with the owners and understand their past performance to take that into account before talking COVID prices. If that's, I think that kind of answers your question. So
yes,
we don't really sit there and take advantage of this situation. We're trying to really give them something at least to be happy with.
Now, I thought it was important for the audience to have a little bit of a foundation for before we get to really the heart of the matter in hotels, especially in the kind of markets that you're talking about. So on the surface, I'm going to look at New York and LA as being gravely challenged at the moment. One, COVID-19, lots of people, especially New York, concentrated area, mass transit, which is being hit hard by the people aggregating together. So that's going to be more impactful to New York. And kind of a melting pot, people coming in. Right now, it's gravely challenged by COVID-19. And that's going to be more amplified with some of the civil and social unrest that we're having in the cities. Now, is COVID-19 and that going to last forever? No, of course not. But it seems to me like it must take some guts to say, I'm going to go into New York, I'm going to go into LA, and I'm going to look for opportunity, even though on the surface you would think things are very, very choppy now. So the only way that's going to work, unless I'm wrong, let me know, is you look at it as an opportunity. Because when people are running one way, that may be time to run in the other direction, to be a contrarian, and that's because in a market dislocation, you could buy, and maybe the owners are not quite ready to sell it this yet, I use the word yet, but you could buy at a distressed opportunity. So we all know that COVID and civil unrest right now has been really challenging. But if you're able to get a 20, 30, 40% discount, that may make it worth it. Right, Marco?
Absolutely. So what we did to anticipate any sort of downturn, we weren't expecting the pandemic, of course. We listed into it in 2018 a REITs in Singapore that basically trades publicly. So now we buy in the US and we sell to the REITs. So in a way, it kind of guarantees an exit to the LPs. And that has been our successful underlying foundation. So if you're a fund or a family office that have some sort of mechanism of the sort, then I think you have a good strategy in place. Otherwise, it's just sit and watch how your asset devaluates over time because of this.
I'm going to bring up now, sticking to that concept of the challenge in cities, and I've spoken to multiple families around the world, multiple real estate operators, and you get people that are brilliant in one direction, but also people that are brilliant in the other direction. And what I mean by that is you could take the view of, listen, we're going to get by COVID-19. It might even take a year to a year and a half, but eventually through treatment and vaccines, we're obviously going to get by it. And we're making enhancements to the civil challenges we're having here in the U.S. and hopefully showing improvement with that. So these are not going to last forever. New York is an epicenter of the world of culture, of restaurants, of Central Park, of the Statue of Liberty, of the world of finance. And okay, I'm going to buy at a discount now. I'm probably not going to make a multiple of my money in a year or two. I understand that. But I have the cash available. I have the potential exit liquidity through the REIT that you noted. And looking 3 to 5 years out, things are going to be okay. That's one way to look at it. But I do have people that are really smart taking the other approach and maybe being too much of a naysayer, but basically saying, no, it's not really going to bounce back. Remote working is working for a lot of white collar industries. You don't need the expensive office space in New York. The world of finance, you could do that anywhere. I could be a brilliant financier in Idaho as long as I have a good internet connection. Might it help to have other amazing people in greater New York around you? Debatable, but that may be only a slight advantage. But here's maybe the really big one. The really big one is regulation and taxes in New York City and California. And you have people now moving to Florida and Texas that are looking at it as less regulation, business friendly, no state taxes. And I could go either way, but I don't know if New York is really going to bounce back for a long time. What do you think?
Well, it's a very provocative question you asked. I think New York City has, because of regulation and the current state of politics in our city, it has been a bit challenging, I must admit. The solution that you talk about, which is to be able to talk virtually with people and so on, I think is more of a short-term solution. At the end of the day, the human contact, the interaction with someone over a dinner in a conference room or whatnot is really what makes that relationship stronger and closes the deal. If you can do that virtually, then I will be able to take my hat down for you, because that's typically very challenging unless they really, really know you. So you have existing relationships and future relationships to be built that virtually, unfortunately, I don't think they work. For the short-term period, yes, absolutely. In terms of New York coming back to market, like you said it yourself in the very beginning, it is a hub. It is an international hub. So people come there for tourism, for business, and so on. So that will not stop. That the moment that somebody hears there's a vaccine, that we can finally start interacting with each other, probably not in the same ways that we did before. But for example, right now I'm in Miami, or I was in Charleston last week. The complete disregard to what New York is like, and they're doing fine. They're rebounding even faster than New York City as of now. We're still waiting and hoping to see that this pandemic has been really under control, but the media tends to be a little bit biased on that particular note as well. So you need to see sometimes for yourself and do that kind of market research, because you're not going to get it by watching the news or reading a newspaper article from home.
And I suppose for hotels in New York and LA, given their epicenters of culture, and again, where people from around the world want to visit, even if it takes 12 to 18 months via treatments and vaccine to get by this, there probably could be a built-up demand for travel from a business perspective and for sure for personal. So again, if you're willing to put up with, you know, what could be a challenging time for 12 to 18 months, there may be a potential nirvana to come if you could be patient.
Yeah, I you just got to be patient, like you said it yourself.
And so in terms of your model and your experiences, and has it been, what, about 20, 22 hotels in the U.S. over the last couple of years?
23 total. Up to date, and we're this month closing on two more, one in Seattle and one in Nashville.
Seattle, talk about a city with some unrest and challenges. But again, I am assuming we'll eventually get through that. I have my own personal opinions about that one. I'm going to save that one for my private podcast. I don't know if I want to be too public about it. It may scare people away. But that, when, again, that issue happening there probably is going to scare some ownership groups, and that provides opportunity to buy if you have the cash, the experiences, and the guts at a discount, and that creates the opportunity. I heard you mention, I kind of ignored it then, but let's jump into it now because it is intriguing. You know, you are going to be a family office. You're going to be a GP and operator. You take in some select other qualified purchaser, family office type investors or institutions as what's known as LPs. But it sounds like besides a traditional exit of 5, 10, 15 years, you also have the opportunity for liquidity through the REIT. If you could just dive into that a little deeper.
Yeah, so the REIT exactly provides us the liquidity. That doesn't mean that someone back in Europe or the US can make me a better offer. I mean, we do have a buy criteria from the REITs into the fund. And if we find a better buyer or better bidder in the US, then we can sell it directly to them. So it doesn't always have to be the REIT, but it's there.
That creates a tremendous amount of liquidity, even theoretically, possibly at a lower purchase price, but it creates the opportunity to have flexibility for liquidity. So that makes it intriguing. It's interesting.
It comes to the LP, right? So the LP can choose 6, 9, 18 months to exit. Oh. We can pull longer. It depends on how we see the market is behaving towards our company.
We'll go a little bit to the next topic, and we may bounce back partially due to our live audience in the chat feature to some questions on the hotels. But now, hopefully, Ferrari, don't get mad at Marco. This is me in the title putting in, it's a great compliment, the Ferrari of motorcycles. But what would you mean by that? What are you looking to do with motorcycles?
We have, diversification has always been a core center to the way we look at global investments, alternatives, and public markets as well. So what we've noticed in the last few years with the birth of Tesla is that the EVs and autonomous cars have become a topic of talk. Tesla became the first automobile company evaluated over $100 billion. I think it's a great model. You buy directly from the manufacturer. You buy it, they build it. So we had a history of fabricating motorcycles and automobiles in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, and 50s. We stopped, I have no idea why. I think we went into the real estate hospitality sector after the 50s, and that's basically been part of our DNA since then. What I did as a family office member is obtain the trademarks, royalties, of those legacy assets that we had and provided a rebirth, rebrand of the old Soriano motorcycle, which was at the time the first manufacturing Spanish company in Spain. So now with this rebirth, what I've done is take the motorcycles and brought it to Northern Italy, which is well known for design, engineering, and manufacturing of the well-known motorcycles, Ducati, Guzzi, Aprilia, Augusta. What I told my designers in Italy was, we need to do better than these guys. I want something absolutely beautiful. That was my first statement. And then I told the engineers that we need to find the solutions to whatever engineering issues currently EVs have. And there were a number of issues. You know, one of them is the way in a motorcycle, you most likely have heard of scooters being electric and cheap, but nobody really understands that those scooters that you're investing in today for $3,000-$4,000 in 2-3 years are done. They won't work anymore. There aren't any parts around the world ready for that. In our case, I'm creating a whole lifestyle around this. I don't want to just be the manufacturer of high-end luxury high-performance motorcycles, but I want to create a club around it. I want to be a service provider for engineering and design in Italy so that your company comes with the Made in Italy brand on it, which has a much more higher luxury value to it. So for the past year, we have been working on it tremendously. We came up with renderings. We're going to be presenting our first prototype and pre-series in November at the biggest festival of motorcycles in the world, which is called EICMA. And that's going to be in Milan. Whether it happens or not, depending on the situation in the world, we're still going to do something privately for friends and family, investors, journalists, and whatnot. So we're making a big comeback after almost 80 years, and there's been loads of articles being written about us, and they're putting us around the same category of Ducati and Harley Davidson. And that makes me happy. I think we're going to be able to do a much better job than those companies because they're too big to pay attention to the little details that engineering in this specific sector, EVs, have not been able to resolve. The word is out there. You know, so we're doing our thing.
Will it be called Soriano Motorcycles?
Oh, absolutely. It's a Soriano motorcycle. That's the name of the brand, but the actual corporation would be Soriano Motori, which stands for Soriano Motors. So I'm really bringing back not just the brand of the Soriano motorcycle, but the actual corporation.
And did I miss it? But when you mentioned Tesla, it just maybe distracted me and popped in my head. Is this a traditional gas engine, or is it going to be powered by electric?
No, it's completely powered by electric, and anything that is ICE, which stands for internal combustion engines, it's right now having a big, big issue. Part of the reason is because people are staying home and nobody really needs to drive around for the time being. And the other situation, and this is funny because you're looking at the motorcycle sector and that's on the rise. And the reason that is because you're more isolated when you're in a motorcycle than when you are in a car. So you have more freedom. So the EVs, fully electric, we've invented our own engine. We've put in place a double engine as well, engineering gears, which bikes that are electric never have. Now they're going to have gears on it. So it will give you the same feeling that an ICE has, only that it won't make the combustion noise that, you know, Harley Davidson, for example, has a pretty strong reputation for that. And that's part of, I think, the reason, and we saw this in the very recent days, that Warren Buffett made a loan to them of $300 million because they were going bankrupt. And listen, I'm a big fan of Harley. It's just every 5 years, they're going into bankrupt. So there's something in the operating management team that is not working. And if Warren Buffett is going to buy it out, most likely, if it goes well, good for them. If it's not, it's going to disappear, which is sad to see a American icon company like that go away.
That is absolutely an American icon company. And although people that don't know me probably, or know me probably wouldn't guess this, but way back during the heyday of the mid-90s, I did own a Harley Sportster and enjoyed it greatly. And one day I would like to get back to riding. It was a lot of fun. So what you're doing effectively, that's an impact play and investment as well, because you're doing something that's not causing carbon emissions, contributing to climate change. Yes. It's more fluid in transportation and more cramped inner cities. So there are certain advantages to it. Very, very intriguing. But like any new or startup business, especially one that's a product with design, manufacturing, engineering, I mean, mm-hmm. this is a significant undertaking. This is probably, sure. I mean, you got a lot going on. You got hotels, we'll get to blockchain in a second. are you choosing a CEO who's going to lead this initiative? How active are you going to be? And I'm assuming you need more money into this.
Yeah. We're usually the first capital in, and we choose, I mean, I'm the founder. I am not the CEO, but I remain as chairman of the board. And we have a great CEO, Sergio Moroni, who had worked in the past for Benetton Colors, you know, have worked for Ducati. I mean, all of my engineers have worked for Ducati in the past, and our designers as well. So we do have a very strong management team, and I think that's part of the whole point. They loved the idea when I pitched this in Italy about a year ago, with the fact that it was a Spanish company with such a strong, iconic presence, that in our logo, we maintain both flags, the Spanish flag and the Italian flag, one on top of each other, so that they can see that there's a strong connection. Today, when you look at competition, if that is something you follow, of course, MotoGP, which is a circuit of motorcycles and brands of the world, Soriano is going to make an appearance in 2022. We're already discussing this with the association so that we can compete and show that our performance and our pilots could be as competitive as they can get in that specific sector. So it's a number of statements that we're making with this comeback.
Yeah, that sure is. I mean, reviving a family brand going back many, many decades ago and launching it with a new twist of, again, not a gas emissions engine, but through effectively electric, yet not only be of aesthetics in terms of how it looks, but in terms of performance, need to keep up with, you know, what people expect.
Very important. Very important. You know, Tesla did pave the way, and I said this name again for relevance because our system is basically going to be adaptable to the charging stations that Tesla have invested worldwide. So I don't have to reinvent the wheel on that. All I have to do is manufacture a vehicle that is compatible with the infrastructure of what Tesla has done worldwide. And now you have a motorcycle that can take you 120 kilometers, about 90 miles per charge, and enjoy it. The challenge you have with EVs, and this is something you probably have in mind, is that you can go for 90 miles and you have to recharge it, and it won't be as fast as refilling the tank with gasoline. You know, so how long is that process? The batteries we're using and the charging system that we've invented as well, it's within 45 minutes. So we're sort of envisioning the future of gas stations to become more like the ones in Italy, for those that have been, which is the auto grills, as opposed to just a gas station. They're actually cafes or restaurants where you can go eat, charge your bike while you're at it, 45 minutes go by, you're on your way for the next 90 miles. So we're envisioning that. I know in the US, there's a huge movement with Carson, because he's part of the cabinet in this current administration, and he handles all of the urban development in the US, and they are extremely bullish on building out the infrastructure for charging stations in the US.
Yeah, no, that makes it intriguing and actually reminds me of another question for hotels and real estate, but we'll bounce back to that after we dive into a little bit of the third subject, which could potentially tie into what you're doing in hotels and motorcycles, but people on the surface aren't going to realize that. And that is going to be blockchain. So many people are going to be familiar with blockchain as an underlying engine to Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. Yeah. And people have varying opinions about crypto, Bitcoin in general, but generally a consensus is that blockchain is very intriguing, and it looks like it's going to be here to stay, and it creates some unique opportunities from a business perspective, including in antiquated industries like hotels being potentially one, or even the manufacturing like you're doing from the motorcycle perspective. Yeah. So talk to us a little bit about the blockchain perspective.
So about 3 years ago, we started looking at the blockchain programming systems, which people were always confusing, especially in a lot of the family office conference. What is blockchain versus cryptocurrencies? And it seemed like this is 3-4 years ago, a very interesting topic. And we started analyzing what can we do differently by implementing this programming into our current global infrastructure with the hotels. What we learned was it wasn't just the transparency of digital print documentation when you're dealing with multiple supply lines, but it was also within the royalty program sector. And everybody's familiar with this topic, because when you have a credit card, when you're staying at a flag hotel like Marriott, Hilton, they'll give you points, reward points. Problem with these points today, and has been for some time, is that you get them for spending money, yes, great, but when you redeem them or when you want to use them, it has to be only within that particular hotel line. So if you have Hilton points, you cannot use those at the Marriott points. But these points are worth money. They do have a nominal value to it. So what we did is use blockchain to create a cryptocurrency of our own as a crypto point reward system by buying back or taking back all of the existing points that we've given to our clients over the last few decades and converted that to a crypto point that now trades on a secondary market based on volume. So your point has an intrinsic value that you can actually see what it is. To you, the consumer, it doesn't really matter because it's a free point. You're not buying it. You're getting it for what? For booking in our hotel through our app, for booking transportation through our app, for booking an event through our app. So that created a company that we call an Airstays, as opposed to Airbnb, Airstays with the Z. And we created this app platform that, as a matter of fact, will be live. It's right now in beta and pilot with both Google Play and Apple Store, but it will be publicly offered and announced in the at the end of July and August. We waited to, with this product and purposely because COVID took place and we knew that this was going to drive down the economy and the hospitality sector. So right now it's a system that it's going to save hotel owners around the world money like crazy because we're not charging you for any booking reservations. Booking, Expedia, or any type of meta search that you use as a consumer when you do your traveling will charge the hotel owner 20, 30, 40%. So per capita, per reservation. So it becomes extremely expensive today, even today, to use those meta searches for people to come and find you. So now we did like a Trojan horse, if you want to call it that, approach where you can go to Airstays, find us, book us, and you get money in return for that. We make money on the fintech, travel tech piece because of that crypto point that you have. We have, you know, several millions of that to be distributed. So,
yeah, that's a, it's a very unique perspective that you're doing, and certainly the trend to where things are headed does remind me a little bit, and going back a little bit to real estate and hotels, do you see the potential of tokenization in terms of where lots of people could own a tiny, tiny piece of a hotel or a piece of real estate that right now is really more dedicated to family office type investors. Mm-hmm. Tokenization kind of, I remember it being a really intriguing thing like 2 years ago, and it seems like it kind of faded away. Where are we headed to that? On
so,
that?
Just to refresh people's memories. So
yes, they need it.
Yes, it was basically taking an existing hard asset, real asset, and breaking it, fractionalizing it in different values that the crypto community could buy into. And basically, you do a pool of investors, you raise capital, now you have your preferred equity LPs or group that is investing with you side to side. It was successful for a couple of situations, and I saw that, but there's still a lot of issues with how that money is being monitored, if there are any compliance levels to be under. It's just too complicated, I think, as of now. We're not tokenizing any of our assets. We don't have a need for that. I think at the end of the day, when we look for to be or to have preferred equity partners, it's real cash. And not debt, you know, for that we have relationships with the big banks. As of now, you know, everything is extremely cheap. The QE that was imposed by the government has driven those loans extremely low. If you have a good relationship with the bank and haven't defaulted on anything with them, then you can refinance or be able to get a debt financing that makes more sense to your acquisitions. You know, tokenization may come back. I don't know yet. We're more on the realm of, you know, rewarding anyone that would book and stay in our hotels and be able to use this within all of the platform and all of the hotels that are participating. So to date, we've interfaced with Amadeus, which is like travel for. Amadeus is a GDS, it's a global distribution system. And it allows you to connect with 10 million hotels worldwide right now. So that means that if you get a crypto point, you can convert it to cash anywhere in the world when you're traveling, or you can just have the hotel accept that crypto point on the entrance intrinsic value and be able to have your glass of wine and salad that typically hotels cannot offer anymore. And I'm sure everybody has experienced this, that if you book through Expedia or Booking and you get to the hotel reception desk will tell you, well, you're not going to get the free salad with us. It's not inclusive because you use these guys. And that goes back to the reason that Expedia charges me 40%, 30%, 20% per reservation, and I can't afford it.
Yeah, they organizations like that certainly have a very intriguing business model. And yes, from the hotel operator, that makes it a little bit more challenging. When you were talking, it reminded me, and this is going to be a little more applicable to my U.S. listeners, but we won't be on it too long, I promise. And that is going to be when you're buying in city environments, obviously you're familiar with opportunity zones. And that creates a tax advantage as well as making an impact investment into more challenged inner city communities that could use revitalization. Does that play into the potential opportunity of buying into more city environments, certain tax advantages and other advantages that you're going to get and benefiting that community as well?
Yeah, we have been looking at the OZs. I know that's a big tax play, but if your approach, and this is our observation, is to save money on taxes and not on growth, then I don't see a point. We concentrate on making growth our number one priority within our portfolio, and then taxes could change. There could be a new tax law by the current administration and it changes. So we're not pinning our strategy for acquisition criteria based on taxable plays in the market.
And among my latter questions as we take it to the home stretch, given generational international experience in Europe, the US, and other parts of the world, and we're in the midst of COVID, you have a deep Rolodex, you talk to a lot of people. What are you seeing family offices be proactive in during this dislocation, if at all? Do you see them hoarding cash and not doing anything, playing in the liquid public markets, looking at dislocations in privates and real estate and buying like we discussed? And kind of what's the difference between the European and the American wealthy families?
Okay, twofold questions.
Yeah, it's a complicated one.
I think the family offices that I know, which are a few, are right now focused and they're staying within their scope of expertise. They're not really looking at alternative investments where they can further diversify their current position. I think that's a mistake, but they all have their own CIOs and approaches, of course. They stay in there and they want to see how they're going to be able to rebound with their existing assets under management. And then on the other end, you have those families that are like, okay, this is an opportunity. This is where we go in and buy. This is where we go in, buy and hold. And then we know we're going to have a good return on that based on experience. You know, we have seen the market in the last 50 years, for example, public markets, I say, if that is your position, to have gone through all sorts of crises. And 75% of those times that we've been down towards a recession, we have come back very, very strongly and actively. So this is data that if you're working with any of the big banks, any financial advisor will be able to tell you and fact check it for you. So that tells you that regardless of whatever we see in pandemics or any sorts of economic downturns, we always come back.
And given multi-generational and experience with heritage in Europe, you know, having seen multiple up and downs, it seems like maybe family office capital, maybe a little more so in Europe, is just very patient. That, again, a city like New York and London and Milan and Paris, I mean, are these going to just disappear and fall off the lexicon? I don't think so. You know, I have no guarantees moving forward. And it does look like it's a new normal, but it's hard to imagine that they're never going to bounce back and be resilient. These cities have been resilient for longer than any of us have been alive. And why would that change moving forward if you look simply at history?
I think Europe have been through so much wars. They have been completely destroyed and they rebuild better and better every time. So I'm very optimistic that that's going to be the case, that we're going to adapt to this new norm they're calling. I think it's just adapting, because we all have to adapt. Change is part of nature. You adapt to it and then you move on. If you don't, then you're going to be one of those companies, like it has been said, within the S&P 500, then in the next decade, 50% of those companies will be gone, that they will be replaced by newer companies that have adapted to newer technologies and have a better understanding on how to promote themselves to the new generation of consumers. Not the baby boomers, not the Gen X, but the Ys, the Zs that people still tend not to understand quite. And that is your future consumers. And we are a capital society. We're based on consumption.
That is for sure. I completely agree with that. And that's been also proven over time in blocks of 20 years. Just because a company is a Fortune 500 public company doesn't mean that their position's going to stay that way forever. 30 years ago, there was no Amazon, there was no Google. Apple wasn't the Apple that we know it now. Things absolutely change. If anything, that's happening more exponential now. The other thing that we forgot to mention in cities that would be to the benefit of them, the Bostons, New York, San Francisco, London, and other cities, is until the pandemic, this is where the younger people wanted to live. They were not going more suburban and more rural. They enjoy the cultural interaction. They're okay with much, much smaller real estate than maybe my generation was, that wanted the 2 acres and a big home. And a lot of that relates to, which again, we didn't discuss, this is where a lot of the great universities and colleges are. They're in Boston, they're in New York, they're in London. Now, I have also strong feelings about the future of education, and I think that will be impacted. But are we going to see that impact in the next year, 5 years? And will these institutions adapt to more modern times and, yeah, become a version of more virtual and online? Many of them that are that iconic in their brand, that are often based in those communities that I noted, will. So, you know, we're in really interesting times. We don't have a crystal ball. We don't know for sure what the future will hold. And some of it is a little scary, but I think we have some things to look back on as well as to look forward to. And for families that are fortunate to be in a position to have time, liquidity, I guess you could say, on their side, this could be a good opportunity for them to buy. I am going to note, because some of our discussion today was a little bit relative to investing, that these are simply for educational purposes. The type of investors and alternative investments should be ultra high net worth individuals, preferably family offices, a minimum of a qualified purchaser. And everyone has different liquidity needs, risk tolerances, and goals. So this is something specific to spark thoughts in your mind, but you have to do your own due diligence before you decide to do anything, of course, from an investing perspective. Marco, on that note, for those that would have an interest in learning more about these initiatives that you're doing, do you keep a personal blog and website? How can they connect with you? How could they learn more?
Yeah, there isn't a blog. We don't do that. But if they can contact us via our website, sorianogroup.com, and there they can also see our portfolio of companies. If they need to learn more about the history of the Soriano Corporation, all they need to do is Google us as the Soriano Corporation, which is also a publicly traded company. Although the Soriano Group is privately held now by me, because I was the one who divested the third generation into this, and focusing on building the fifth generation now with my 3 children and my sister's children. So, you know, that's also legacy for those family offices that are looking into building a legacy type of case scenario. So yeah, be happy to have a chat with anyone. Sorianogroup.com. It's the best way to write to me directly. The office will always pass to me whatever it is you're doing, just to have a conversation and see where we're at.
That's fantastic. And everyone, we're very fortunate today to have Marco Antonio Soriano on the show. I'm Angelo Robles. I'm the host of Angelo Robles's Effective Family Office podcast on Apple, Spotify, iHeart, Stitcher, and other platforms. Our YouTube channel, and we'll make a video of this as well, is simply Family Office. So Family Office is my YouTube channel. And I'm the founder and CEO at Family Office Association, a global membership organization dedicated to families of great success and their single family offices, providing a tremendous amount of original proprietary content, thought leadership, hosting global events, and in today's times, doing a tremendous amount, usually Monday through Friday, hosting online video meetings for our members, occasionally some select guests, and lots of other member benefits during challenging times that we've added on. It really has been, again, like you said, Marco, if you don't adapt, if you're not resilient, if you're now not digital in today's world, you will become a dinosaur instantly. This is not where, oh, well, it's going to be a slow death. There'll be 20 or 30 years. You're gone. So we needed to adapt it. I think I did that pretty swiftly, and we're still adapting because there's a unique dynamic that we're going through. And again, I'm finding it kind of invigorating. This has been a very intriguing time for us. The website is familyofficeassociation.com. My email is angelo@familyofficeassociation.com. And as noted, very active on social media, Instagram, LinkedIn. I mentioned the YouTube already, so feel free to follow us. On that note, thank you to our live audience today. Of course, thank you to Marco Antonio Soriano, our special guest. Look forward to the next time. Thank you all. Marco, thank you so much.
All right.
Ta-da. Thank you. Bye-bye. Ta-da.